dad was caught with like $8 million, six bricks.
Yeah. That's why I wanted to be just like him. 8 million, shit.
I was more intrigued by the gamblers than the hustlers. Cause I knew if I sit there and watch them long enough, it was just like TV. Someone in the end gonna get shot, someone gonna get stabbed, someone gonna get whooped, because in the end, someone is gonna be cheap. And they figure they should have more. And this is what started the war. And they see a figure which they think is something to glorify, something that's famous, something that to look up to. You know, you can't look up to something like that on my past like that when I was an instrument of the destruction of my own neighborhood. I'm true about my redemption. I owe this to myself to right a lot of the wrongs I did out there. I owe this to my community to try to rebuild back what I destroyed out there. I owe this to my people to stop them to thinking that this is a life they need to live.
Hey yo squad, what's the drill? Back with another video, man. And before there was a rap superstar known as Lil Durk who was holding down the charts with the most 2021 Billboard entries alongside Taylor Swift, before there was Lil Durk the Hood Savage, there was his father, the Chicago GD head honcho Dante Banks, also known as Big Durk, running a multi-million dollar empire under GD founder Larry Hoover and sparking the BD vs. GD war that still sheds blood today. But who was the elusive father of Durkio Smirkio? Well, thanks to him gaining his freedom and sitting down for an interview, his life on the streets and behind bars and for the future has become known. So without further ado, let's skip the play-play and get down to business. Dante Banks is the Big Durk, the pops of one of the biggest rappers that the world has come to know. Inglewood, Chicago is where he called home. Him and his family were doing their best to cope. It was 10 of them, 7 boys and 3 girls, and they had to witness how dark and distorted the world was as a child with a mother that's an addict. Always unstable, always moving around to survive, it really wasn't easy.
We didn't have no suitable or no stable home type of environment. My mother, who we loved dearly, me and my brothers and sisters, she had 10 children, 7 boys and 3 girls. So we moved around a lot because of the situation which...
Banks often had to go find his mother most of the time because she was hooked on a particular substance at the time called sherm sticks that Banks describes as turning humans into zombies to the point that they would just freeze up.
So my mother, you know, it was very traumatizing what it was because I used to have to come in from school and I used to have to literally find my mother to find out where she at. Because back then, we're talking about the early 80s, what you call sherm sticks, happy sticks, wicked sticks. I don't know what name they might have gave from whatever side of town they were selling them from. But these things, when you smoke these things, they was like turn the individual into a zombie.
The only time Banks felt anything close to what a normal home life was when they were staying with their grandmoms. For some reason, grandparents just have that love foundation built into them, and luckily, his was no different.
The only recollection of a stable home or someone's stable home that I had was when we stayed with my grandmother, and that was in the Inglewood area.
One thing she instilled in him that would be his saving grace later in life was his connection to family. Banks and them didn't have the chance to go down a better route. Being in the ghetto, the streets started controlling his mentality from early. In fact, 3 of his older brothers were in prison by the time he was just 12 years old.
You know, my oldest brother, I'm like the 4th or the 10th, and my 3 older brothers was locked up. You know, this is a family that no stranger to the penal system.
That left Banks to step up as a man for the house, but things would only pop off that would turn him into a savage that he became. Banks would come home one day to see their things being tossed out on the street, but what hit him even deeper was the fact that he saw the pain and tears running down his mother's face. Right then and there, Banks made a decision that he was going boss up, and that was the birth of Big Durk. Might sound messed up, but the streets was like a playground for Big Durk. Since a kid, he was more attracted to the gambling and the drama of the street, sitting and waiting for someone to get shot, where the average kid would be afraid. Big Durk was excited. Big Durk wanted it all, the whips, the chicks, and the chips. As a youngin', he turned to a cousin he had in the game for some work, and he got his first package, an 8-ball.
I had a cousin who dealt and dabbled a little bit. And I went to my cousin, I told her, I said, I need some work.
Did you see her?
Yes.
Okay.
I went to her and said, I need some work. She gave me an eight ball.
That completed his full transition to Big Dirt. Just a high schooler at Paul Robinson High School, Banks was already a pro in the game and moving weight. His grandma's was the reason he stuck it through and finished school. But what's messed up is that school was where he became affiliated with the GDs after they slid through looking for the most respected out the bunch to begin having some organization in the neighborhood.
So now the neighborhood, now they calling for neighborhood to be organized now.
Big Dirk had the stash, the soldiers, and the respect, so he was the perfect candidate.
Already had guys working with me prior to them coming over there.
This was where Big Dirk gained a new level of stripes to his name. Before he accepted the offer on the table to become the big shot of the neighborhood, he met with the infamous co-founder of the GDs, Larry Hoover, in prison. At the time, Larry Hoover was serving triple-digit years for a number of charges. The most serious was a six-life sentence verdict after being found guilty for federal conspiracy, extortion, and continuing to engage in a criminal enterprise. Big Dirk was running things. He was the man with the plan. He had the vision to oversee the block and keep things under control through whatever means that required, and that had the law on him heavy. Cops tried a number of times to put him away for life with a hit and attempted hit charge and numerous charges for illegal substances. Big Dirk was too slippery to hold, though, but his luck came close to running out when unexpected issues in the streets popped up. If the fiend's depending on you for that rock, then if the product runs out, that's a problem. And that's exactly what happened, and Big Dirk made an executive decision to go outside his regular source in a hotspot to get some. That decision nearly cost him his freedom. Big Dirk ended up in a high-speed chase in his 64 Malibu with his sis, outpacing the cops and dipping while narrowly escaping with his life. The pipeline was flowing again. But if there wasn't animosity and gunplay, would it really be the streets? Probably not. That's what came along with the lifestyle, and it went down in history as one of Chicago's most grimy times. Big Dirk was in the heart of it. In fact, he was involved in the start of the GD vs. BD feud that has to this day been getting youngins murked. It was an all-out warfare between Big Dirk and the Freemans, which had Jerome King Shorty Freeman calling the shots for the BDs. Big Dirk and the Freemans go way back, but they wanted more territory, and that put into play the circle of bloodshed that seems to have no end.
They was asking for more than what they was entitled to. And being that way, Kirk, only draws out a line that you can't cross now. I need this territory, they need that territory. And they wouldn't yield to the territory, and they figured they should have more. And this is what started the war over territory.
Big Dirk was holding it down, and his smuggling empire was only expanding larger and gaining more of a fearsome reputation. He was rolling in more money than he could spend, and at this time he felt untouchable. In his mind, his organization was running around the clock, so he was always a step ahead of the cops. Big Dirk's vision for retirement was when he decided to stop, but he would soon find out that the cops had other plans.
That I'm on the street 24/24. The police only on the street 8 hours. There's no way they can stop what I'm doing, and I control more time.
Cops finally caught their lucky break, and on July 1994, a judge sentenced the former kingpin to life. It was game over, no respawns, no do-overs, no restart from the save point, or so it seemed. Big Dirk's downfall was some of his own people's, and a document of the investigation and case showed just how it all came crashing down. They had Big Dirk like the El Chapo of Chicago, stating that between 1991 and 1993, he purchased powder coke to manufacture, distribute, and sell in the streets 24/7, 365. Big Dirk had a well-oiled money-making machine, but where there's a stash in money, there's cops, and there will be snitches that hit closer to home than you ever thought. Big Dirk's own cousin, Tasha Woods, who conducted a sale of 3 kilograms of cocaine from Big Dirk and was around to see the manufacturing and packaging of the product, turned snitch when pressed with the football numbers in a sale. Her, along with her pops, sang like their freedom depended on it, and it did. Testifying on behalf of the government at trial in order to gain immunity, Tasha and her pops told the seeing Mr. Banks received powder cocaine from his suppliers, then him and others used it to cook that poison, then packaged the goods in smaller quantities for sale on the street. From the size of the bag to the price on the street, they told it all. Tasha Woods held nothing back. She went on to target even the right-hand men of Big Dirk. Alton Mills, Robert Shipp, Mario Dunlap, and Michael Wills, even Big Dirk's shorty, Monica, who was involved in counting the cash. Everyone wants the benefits of the game, but when it comes time to stand and do the time, tongues get loose. Tasha squealed on Big Dirk's girl, but the story gets even more wild. Tasha Woods was the girlfriend of Mario Dunlap. Love was thrown out the window though. Old girl was fighting the legal system for her life. When cops took down Mills, it ended in a high-speed chase with Buddy tossing the product out the whip while trying to escape. They didn't even find what he tossed, but it didn't matter because the cops had on record a phone call from Big Dirk's girl after the bust, and she updated Big Dirk on Mills' situation, stating that Mills had candy when cops skirted behind him. The evidence was piling up one on top of the other, and feds had recorded phone conversations on dang near everything. After Mills was got, they intercepted a conversation between Big Dirk and his girl and Robert Shipp talking in code about Mills being caught lacking and was taken in after tossing the coke. Didn't take cops too much longer to figure out what candy meant though. The feds' next move was raiding a stash house where they found over 1 mil in cash and about 10 kilos of coke. Big Dirk was arrested and the conspiracy gained momentum. Big Dirk slipped up after being caught getting recorded on conversations instructing Robert Shipp to make sure everyone stayed in school, which authorities figured to mean to let everyone keep silent and don't run their mouth about nothing. With the records and even video surveillance of money from dealing being counted by dealers, it was a wrap. The nail in the coffin was Big Dirk's supplier ratting on him to get a reduced sentence. Escaping the life sentence was all but impossible with the evidence and the laws in place for selling rocks, which they penalized much harder than powdered coke. In fact, the district judge even found it unfair, but his hands were tied with the laws in place. According to many, including Big Dirk, the law was racially biased and the logic flawed for the other reason that you needed powdered coke to make crack. The end result of the case was that 3 to 4 gang members, which included Big Dirk, getting life, 2 others getting 30 years, and Big Dirk's girl, 20 at the time, and a mother getting 10 years. Big Dirk's prison time was no joke. The environment was harsh.
I mean, it was, you asked about traumatized. That's the second part of traumatized, because I went to an old prison. I didn't go to one of the prisons that, you know, the new built prisons.
He was to spend his days behind bars, but as God would have it, he found spirituality through learning the Muslim faith, and a new law enabled Big Dirk to walk free in February 2019 after serving 25 years and winning his appeal. He was back home to see his son, his pride and joy, Lil Dirk, rise to the top of hip-hop. Reunited with his family, he was on to bigger and positive things. Today, Big Dirk partners with Chicago Cred, create real economic destiny as a life coach to change the community and keep the youth away from living a gang lifestyle. His life story is known as From Life Sentence to Life Saving, an inspiration that people can change and be better, and a deterrent from chasing a life in the streets. After all his and his family's losses, it's good to see positive things happening in their lives. So there you have it. Thanks for kicking it with your boy. Appreciate the love and support. I'll catch y'all when I spin back round for the next one. And remember, stay smart, stay alert, and stay real. I'm out, y'all.